Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, whenever you're watching this program.
Thanks for watching.
Welcome to, yes, an excellent point. Thank you for watching. And welcome to another scintillating episode of Books and Banter. I, of course, am Paul W. Marino, and my co-host here, to my left and your right, is the one, but not the only, Roger J. Urban.
No, there were three of us at one point. My father, me, and my oldest son. Now there's my oldest son and me.
So you are Roger J. Urban, the tooth.
The tooth, true. But now I'm the one.
So what have you brought for us today?
I brought one of my favorite books, especially if you're interested in World War II. And it's a book by John Tolan. Now, John Tolan's a pretty good author. He writes on a number of different subjects. I think, I'm not sure if his, all of his books are listed here, but they should be. Oh yeah, No Man's Land, Adolf Hitler, The Rising Sun, The Last 100 Days. And this gentleman lives in Danbury, Connecticut, which is not that far.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to talk to him, give him a call. Anyhow, John Tolan, the title of the book is Infamy. The subtitle is Pearl Harbor and Its Aftermath. Now, a lot of people seem to know a lot about Pearl Harbor. I thought I did until I read this book. This is a fascinating book to read if you're interested in the beginning of World War II. That is our beginning of it. We weren't involved in World War II directly until Pearl Harbor, and this is what this book is all about, Pearl Harbor and its aftermath. John Tolan is a good author. If you haven't read any of his books, if you're a history nut, or just enjoy reading his history, I strongly recommend John Tolan's books. He's written several. I don't know if I've got them listed here. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But this is one of my favorites. He has written, aside from this book, a book called No Man's Land about World War I, Hitler, the pictorial documentary of his life, Adolf Hitler, The Rising Sun, The Last 100 Days, The Dillinger Days, But Not in Shame, and The Story of the Bulge, and then Ships in the Sky, obviously about aircraft. But this one is about World War II, specifically about Pearl Harbor and what happened immediately afterward. Pearl Harbor was an unmitigated disaster that really didn't have to happen. We had sufficient warning that the Japanese were up to something. And the only thing that didn't occur to us is that they would strike as far east as they did. We expected that they would be in the Philippines, Southeast Asia, but not in Hawaii, of all places. Well, they did. They struck at Hawaii. And why did they do that? Well, the geniuses, and I guess they did what they had to do, that led the Navy in World War II at the beginning, or the prior to World War II, I should say, were absolutely certain that they would, that Pearl Harbor was a safe place to be. So our fleet, the main fleet, was at anchor there. Now, if a ship is at anchor, it takes a fair amount of time for it to get underway, that is to move. You have to make sure that the boilers are cooking, you've got adequate steam, because they were all steam powered at that time, and that the crew was all on board, and you had your ammunition and you had your aircraft, especially on the carriers. So the sneak attack that they had planned was just absolutely phenomenal. You would have thought that knowing that we were going to be going to war sooner or later, that we would have had some kind of reconnaissance out beyond Pearl Harbor.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't. And I thought it was interesting, having lived on Guam, that they didn't try to take those islands first. But it was almost immediately thereafter that they took Guam. The interesting thing that I have, when I was stationed on Guam, my duty station was right at the harbor, right alongside it practically. And my job was to deal with communications intelligence, I should say, and the distribution of high priority messages. And by distribution, that means when we got them in to our place, we had to determine where they should be sent to other than us if they weren't already addressed. So I had a lot of them that came in. Most of them were coded for the higher ranking officers at Pearl Harbor, and then the Air Force and Army units that were stationed there, of which I really can't enumerate. I don't know that much about them. But I know that they had a heavy presence there as well. But the Navy presence was amazing. And during this time, that was our main port west of the West Coast, Pearl Harbor in Hawaii. We never thought that the Japanese would attack Hawaii. They did, with devastating results. Now, the attack was devastating in its effect, but the long-term effect proved to be almost beneficial, because the Navy at the time of Pearl Harbor was, I want to say, run by the battleship admirals.
Mm-hmm.
And because the battleship was the primary ship of war in those days, little was thought by most of them about aircraft carriers, which was mind-blowing, really, because I won't want to say the aircraft carriers won the war, but they did a lot. And without them, we would probably be speaking Japanese at this point. Anyhow, infamy, the attack on Pearl Harbor. Did we know about it? What's your thought?
We knew about it shortly after it happened.
Of course.
No, I don't think we knew about it in advance.
We knew they were up to something. We just didn't know what, when, and where. That is, the United States, those that ran the Navy in particular, felt that they would strike not at Pearl Harbor, but at the outlying islands and areas that the U.S. commanded. The strike at Pearl Harbor was absolutely devastating, in a way. A lot of men died. Almost all of our battleships, which were anchored there, were destroyed or put out of commission for a long period of time. And that actually turned out to be, I hate to say it this way, but a blessing in disguise, because the battleships that we had there were antiquated. They were just post-World War I.
Mm-hmm.
And they were definitely outclassed by anything the Japanese had, and they had some ships. Aircraft carriers were not at Pearl Harbor, and that was a good thing, because when they survived Pearl Harbor, that still left us with an attacking force. That was one of the major problems, the major mistakes the Japanese made, is they went after battleships, and their accompanying cruisers and destroyers and what have you, and the land base, et cetera. They hit the communication station to a degree, but it was still able to function. And the Army base was hit, Army Air Force, and it was a devastating attack. No two ways about it. But this book, Infamy, covers it from just prior to the attack to the result of it. It's a fascinating book to read. It's a good author.
Is there any mention there
excuse me,
of Alan Rockwell McCann?
I believe so. Let me check for a second here.
Because I know he was there during the attack.
Admiral McCann now?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm not sure he was admiral then. He was captain of a small ship.
Uh-huh.
And the planes were flying past him, going after the battleships.
Right.
And he began coordinating the rescue efforts.
I know the name and I've read about him, but I don't know if he was mentioned here. No, I don't see it. I'm sure he was at some point. Pardon me? No, he's not mentioned.
Well, I do see a McCann there.
Where?
No, it's McCrae.
Yeah. I think McCann came along shortly thereafter. The primary officer involved in the Navy's version of Pearl Harbor was Admiral Kimmel, and he took the brunt of the blame for it, for what transpired, and that is the ships at Pearl Harbor. Now, if you know anything about Pearl Harbor, I've been there, and it's an interesting place. There's a very, it was somewhat narrow channel that leads inland towards Honolulu, and Pearl Harbor is right at the head of that. And you have to wonder, because it was an obvious place to be attacked if they were going to be attacked. Now, I also was stationed on Guam, and Guam was attacked pretty much at the same time. But by the time they hit Guam, they had at least had a day or two's notice that something drastic had happened, and it was drastic. Our battleship force was wiped out, absolutely wiped out. Cruisers were hit pretty hard. The destroyers were hit fairly hard. The one thing that wasn't hit too hard, if at all, were the submarines. And immediately thereafter, the U.S. had launched a submarine war against Japan, which was extremely effective all the way through the war. Now, did we lose submarines? Yes. Did we lose battleships? Oh, yeah. Did we lose aircraft carriers? Oh, yeah. You name it, we lost them. Not all of them, but most of them. The battleships that they sunk were World War I and just post-World War I vintage. They're old. Could they do a good job? Sure, they could steam and they could add pretty good sized guns, but they weren't anything like what came afterwards. So the fleet was devastated, and it took quite a while for it to really fully recover. The Japanese also attacked the air bases, namely Hickam Field and Bellows Field. The Naval Air Station at, what the hell is it called? Alupu Head. Never heard of it, but, and I was in Hawaii for a while. But it was just amazing. It was just amazing. Schofield Barracks and the Army areas, Wheeler Field, which is an Army Air Base, were almost in the center of the main island, the Big Island, and they were hit, especially Wheeler Field. Now, Wheeler Field at that time was the home of the Army's largest bomber, and that was the B-17, which was used with devastating results in Europe. However, not so much in World War II in the Pacific until the end. And it wasn't the B-17 at the end, it was the B-29, the big one. And that dropped the big one. Matter of fact, they dropped two of the big ones. But that was later on. But they when they attacked, they really clobbered us. They hit Schofield Barracks, was the main Army base, and that was really pretty much in the center of the island.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, they hit Pearl Harbor. They hit Iwa, which is a Marine base and airfield. A little bit of damage in Honolulu, but not much. Then they took out Bellows Field, which was an Army airfield, Army Air Force airfield. Interestingly enough, there were two waves. The first wave was absolutely devastating, and that hit at 7:45 a.m. It wasn't until 8:50 the second wave came in. Another devastating attack. And you would have thought that they would have been better prepared, but they really weren't. They were still recuperating from the first one. And it's amazing to me that the Japanese didn't try to take Hawaii. They could have.
Mm-hmm.
They certainly had the men, the aircraft, and the material, and ships to do it. Japanese didn't have one thing that they really needed, and those were landing ships. They still used the old method of a transport coming in and dropping gangways and guys mm-hmm. running off those. So that they were lacking in that regard. But
so a landing ship rams onto the beach and opens
some.
A pair of gates?
Yep, some. My last duty station was on a landing ship, and one of the newer ones, and it's called an LSD, landing ship dock. If you watch any of the old World War II things, the bows open like that, and stuff, and a mm-hmm. ramp comes down, and the stuff they were carrying goes out. Well, on our ship, we didn't have bow doors. We had a stern door in the rear. And when that opened, we had mostly Amtraks on board. And those were lightly armored vehicles with treads, like a tank.
Mm-hmm.
And they were meant to haul men. Now, they probably had a couple of machine guns at best to defend themselves, but that was it. The ship that I was on came later. The LSDs, landing ship docks, came a little bit later on in the war. The one I was on was a fairly modern one, and that we carried Amtraks. We also had a small flight deck for helicopters, including attack helicopters if we needed them, but we didn't. And we took part in landings, even at that stage, and that was in Vietnam. We landed, I don't know if we, yeah, we took a couple of beaches that were occupied by the enemy, but didn't take a lot of shell fire, and they were lightly occupied. So we were able to take back most of the coast very quickly. But that was in Vietnam. In World War II, the Japanese thought with the blow that they struck, that it would be years before we were able to come back at
mm-hmm.
them. Years. Didn't happen that way. Some of the fleet was still available. None of the battleships, they were gone. So, which was kind of a blessing, because what happened was we built newer ones and better ones. The Missouri, for example, if you've ever seen the newer ones, is one of the first. Huge guns, 16-inch guns, And I don't know if you know what that means, but a 16-inch gun.
16-inch bore.
Right. That's a big bullet. A big
yeah.
bullet. Our ship had 3-inch 50s.
Mm-hmm.
So 3-inch, a little bit bigger than a 3-inch. But it was mainly due for, small boats and small craft and aircraft. Our aircraft capability on my ship was not that good. But we always steamed in formation with those that was their primary job, is to provide air cover. So we were pretty well protected. But at Pearl Harbor, it was a complete disaster. And any book that you read will tell you that. We expected to be hit, but we thought that they would be first hit in the Philippines. They didn't realize that the Japanese were capable of doing both, hitting Hawaii
mm-hmm.
and the Philippines. Now, in Hawaii, at Pearl Harbor, of course, and the battle that took place there, they didn't land any forces. On the other islands, they did. And they quickly took over some of them. Guam, which was one. The Philippines. They were unbelievably strong after Pearl Harbor, that is the Japanese. It took us some time to figure out what we could do and how we could do it. So it was a fiasco. Now, could it have been prevented? With hindsight, you would have to say yes, but nobody thought that the Japanese would be able to steam across the Pacific to Hawaii with a strike force. And they did. Completely blew us away. There were one or two warnings that went in before the attack, but they didn't pay a heck of a lot of attention to it. That is the powers that be. I was stationed on Guam, initially at the communications station, which was up in the hills. Reason for that was it was protected by big mountains, and we could put our antenna on those mm-hmm. hills, you know. So we could talk to the Philippines, we could talk to Southeast Asia, and we could even talk to Africa and the United States if we wanted to. As a matter of fact, in the holidays, we would open up the transmitters to California and let the guys try to call home, which they did, some of them, most of them. Very interesting place. The island was fascinating. My wife, when she joined me there, couldn't believe how small it was. And she expected it, you know, a pretty big place. It's not. We took on what we used to call a boonie stomp. Now, if you get away from the main areas, which are primarily along the coast, and you go inland, you hit jungle. Now, not the kind of jungle you see in Southeast Asia, but it was jungle. I took a group, we went on what we called a boonie stomp, and that means you went out into the boondocks, and we climbed this hill, and at the top of the hill was an old American tank that had been knocked out, that they had just left there, and Japanese bunkers, what have you, that were obviously hit and destroyed. It was a very interesting thing. My wife hated it. It was a long haul, it was hot, and she just wasn't prepared for that. So we made a number of rest stops, I should say. But working on the islands was fascinating. I enjoyed it. My job, which I can't talk too much about, dealt with communications
yep.
and communication security. And that's about all I can say about it, what I did. We also were a major intercept. That is, we could listen in to anything mm-hmm. in the Pacific, and sometimes in Europe, depending on the weather. So we got all kinds of messages in, and they went strictly to the crypto guys and for decoding. And we were reading the communist stuff pretty regularly.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what they did with it after that, I don't know. We would get the message in, decrypt it, and send it on to the powers that be. And they did what they did with it. But it was interesting. We got first shot at a lot of the things that were happening. But this is a good book.
Well, you know, I was going to say I'm reminded of something I read about Howard Hughes, that shortly before the war began, or during the war in Europe, he produced a new plane which he tried to interest the army in, and they said no. But the Japanese were very interested in it and took all kinds of measurements.
Yep.
And that was what they based the Zero on. And then once the war was over, he got called up before Congress. What did you give this plane to the Japanese for? Why didn't you give it to us?
Go ahead.
And on that cheery note,
I was just going to say, at the start of the war, the Zero was a dominant fighter in the Pacific. We had nothing that would match it.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. We had some that would come close, especially the Navy. We had these fighters that were designed halfway between World War I and World War II to start with. They were old, they were slow, they were very vulnerable, and they were underarmed. Later on, different story. Go ahead.
All right. So, as I told you earlier, I brought two books and a new story.
Oh, boy.
And this new story is actually, again, a reworking of an old story. When I was a wee little boy in elementary school, I was told to write a story, and I came up with something I called Down the Slot. And it was about two little boys, brothers. The younger one falls through a slot in the earth, and his brother goes after him, and it leads to a fabulous land, not unlike the Big Rock Candy Mountain, except for kids. And that recurred to me, and last night, while I was at the meeting at City Hall, something clicked, and I came up with a basic plot that I jotted down, and when I got home, this is what I wrote. The slot. I don't know what to say. It's the damnedest thing I've ever seen. The damnedest thing I've ever lived through. Start at the beginning? Okay. I'm Frank Finlay. I live on South Road in Peru, No, not the country. Peru, Massachusetts. If you're not going to listen, why the hell am I talking?
Good question.
Okay. Just don't interrupt with any more stupid questions. Fine. So I live on South Road in Peru, Massachusetts, southwest of Garnet Pond. Yes, it's a real town. Small one, though. One of the highest elevations in the state. So a year ago, July, I was out hiking in the woods west of my house. Yeah, gorgeous woods up there. Anyway, I'd walked a couple of miles when I tripped on something. It was a hole. My foot sank into it, and I went flying. Damn near broke my ankle. When I landed, my foot was still in the hole. I sat up and started working it free. Boy, was it stuck. The more I tried to pull it free, the deeper it seemed to go. Then I realized the earth, rocks, and twigs around it were flowing down. I sat for a while, just jiggling my foot, watching the detritus flowing down. When suddenly a section of ground 2 feet long collapsed. I got my foot out of there at last, and I started to see just how big that hole was. It was a good 2 feet across and wider than that. I couldn't tell how wide, but I saw earth sag for a good way. I found a thick fallen branch and poked at the ground where it was sagging. It collapsed and fell away. I kept poking, and in 10 minutes, I'd opened the hole up completely. It was a slot, 2.5 feet wide by 5 feet long. Except where the edge of the forest floor edged over it, the walls were sheer, the corners sharp, and I couldn't see how far down it went. I found a good-sized rock, must have weighed about 2 pounds, and dropped it in. I didn't hear anything for a while, then a soft plunk echoed up out of it. I spent a good half hour gathering fallen branches so I could cover it up. I wanted solid wood on top of it so no one else might fall into it. Then I made for home, marking my trail as I went. As soon as I got in, I called my friend Jerry Thompson and told him all about it. We made a date for him to come over the next day so I could show it to him. He showed up bright and early next morning, carrying an industrial flashlight and 300 feet of rope. "What's the rope for?" I asked. He grinned and said, "In case we want to explore." I rolled my eyes. Jerry was always more adventurous than me. I packed my biggest flashlight and we headed into the woods. We found the spot without any trouble and uncovered it. It looked just as freaky as it had the day before. Jerry whistled and swore a few times. We shone our flashlights down it and marveled at how smooth the walls were, as if they'd been cut with a knife, and how crisp the corners were. We looked down as far as our lights would reach. Jerry figured the slot was about 30 feet deep, and then it opened into a much bigger space. We tossed in another rock and listened for the plunk. When it came, Jerry tried to calculate the depth in his head, couldn't, then pulled out a piece of paper and a pencil and tried to calculate it again. He still couldn't do it. He grinned at me and said, "That's one deep hole, partner." Then he tied off his rope around a tree, good 3 feet in diameter. I was tempted to tell him to be careful, but I didn't. For one thing, he'd have laughed, but for another, he was careful. He knew how to climb, and while he was adventurous, he wasn't stupid, and he wasn't careless. He put his gear on, clipped himself to the line, then tied a second line in a bowline, and backed up to the slot. He lowered himself into the opening, slid down, talking all the while. He commented on the walls, calculated the depth, and so on. When he got to the bottom of the slot and was hanging in open space, he said his figuring about the depth of it was right. It was about 30 feet. He went down a little further and studied the roof of the cave. "Nothing special," he said. Also, that it was a little creepy hanging there without walls around him. It was about to get a whole lot creepier. He kept going down until he figured he'd reached about 60 feet. He suddenly went silent. The rope made a sudden twang and slapped against the wall of the slot. As taut as it had been, it went even tauter. I tried pulling on it, but couldn't even lift it from the ground. The loops around the tree creaked, and the tree groaned. Looking up at it, I could see it was leaning toward the slot. That tree was 3 feet in diameter. It had been growing there since before my parents were born, and a rope looped around its roots were making it tilt. I yelled down to hold to Jerry, but he didn't answer. Then, oh God, then, the rope snapped. The loose ends fled across the ground and vanished down the slot. I screamed at Jerry until my throat was hoarse. The tree whipped back and forth a few times. I covered the slot again and ran all the way home. When I got there, I called the state police and told them I needed a rescue crew. They didn't like my story, but a couple cruisers were outside my house in 20 minutes, and some first responders were following them. I led the troopers out to the site and uncovered the slot. They looked at the slot, shook their heads, and looked at the rope, expecting to find it cut, I guess. Of course, it wasn't cut. It had snapped. Impossibly. It was too new and too strong, but it had snapped. Drake dropped in a rock, waited to hear it hit bottom, and shook their heads when they heard it. The way they looked at each other said it all. This was way, way beyond their pay grade. They got on the radio and ordered up an emergency crew that could climb. The crew wouldn't be there till the next day, but the troopers told me that as deep as that hole was, there was no way Jerry could have survived. They showed up the next morning outside my house with a ton of equipment and hauled it into the woods with a caravan of 4x4s, some of them pulling trailers. When we got to the site, they goggled at the slot and looked over the snapped ropes with disbelief. Then they set up a gas-powered generator, fired it up, and put a big tripod over the hole, then aimed a laser down inside. In 2 minutes, they had an accurate measurement, or so they said. Said it was 1,000 feet deep. Next, they set up some industrial floodlights pointing straight down and took some photos. Got some good ones of the slot, said it was amazing there were no tree roots growing out into it. I hadn't even noticed that, but it was true. In a forest, roots grow out in all directions, get tangled with each other. If there's a hole in the way, they grow out into it. They can poke holes in concrete tubing and seriously clog it up. But not here. Earth or stone, there was nothing coming out of those walls. They let a camera down on a line, taking pictures automatically every few seconds. They got it down 100 feet, then hauled it up again. Then they decided to send a man down. They hung a big pulley from the tripod with a steel cable passed through it. The electric motor was on one of the trailers. They braced it securely, turned it on, and lowered their man down the shaft. He talked to them over a radio as he went out of sight. They kept a lively conversation going. The man gasped when the shaft opened out into that huge space. He shone his light up at the ceiling and said it looked as though it held up a couple acres minimum. He couldn't see any walls. When he got down to 60 feet, the radio went dead. The line sang and ran through the pulley. One of the men was shouting into the radio. They reversed the motor, feeding the line out. In seconds, it was whining. The braces on the trailer snapped off and the trailer started rolling toward the hole. Somebody got on the 4x4 and spun his tires. They raced to get the caravan in line and gang them together. By the time they got that done, the trailer was at the edge of the pit. They managed to pull it maybe a foot away. The electric motor was straining, whining, and putting out smoke. There was a loud snap as the pulley broke off the tripod. Gunning their engines, They gained a couple more inches. The motor blew up and this line started whizzing out. Someone slammed on a brake. The line went so taut it dragged the caravan back to the edge of the hole. Somebody shouted, "Cut it loose, cut it loose." The guy on the radio was still shouting, still not getting any reply. There was another loud bang as the line snapped and flew down the hole. Then somebody was shouting. Not me, though. I was too horrified. The thing most were shouting was, "What the hell happened? That was steel cable. It can't break." When word got out, the state police put up a cordon around the slot. The next day, a bunch of Army guys arrived and cut a road into the site. They cleared out 3 acres of forest and surrounded it with a chain-link fence topped with barbed wire. They patrol it with armed guards. I've talked with the scientists they brought in, though I don't know what to tell them. They don't tell me a damn thing. And that's the story.
Hmm. Is that going to be the end?
That is the end.
Huh. Interesting.
I was originally thinking of adding that they try to drill into the sides of the slot, you know, and blast it open wider, but nothing can penetrate it.
Hmm.
But I decided if the Army is researching that, they're not going to tell anybody what they're finding except people in the Pentagon. So, one of the books I brought is another Uncle John's bathroom reader.
Oh boy.
The all-purpose bathroom reader. One thing about Uncle John is there's always something interesting in here. How to drive people nuts.
Yeah.
Bored? Here's a thought. Why not drive the people around you absolutely insane? How, you ask? This is adapted from a Maxim magazine article by our good friend Uncle Edgester. Call an addiction hotline and explain that you're hooked on phonics. Go to the airport wearing a suit of armor and try walking through the metal detector. Wash out a gas can, punch a hole in it, then fill it with water and walk down a busy lunch hour sidewalk while smoking the biggest cigar you can find. Go to the polar bear enclosure at the zoo and shout, "Come on, Larry, that's enough. Take off that costume and come back to the office." Fill an inflated date with helium and release it at rush hour on a windy day. Chase it down the street yelling, "Come back here, you tramp." Call National Acme Company. Ask if they have any products you could use to kill a roadrunner. In the middle of the night, noisily bury a fully dressed mannequin in your backyard. Arrange lawn furniture on the fresh mound and sit down on it quickly when the police arrive. Get a video camera and microphone and chase a local TV news crew around. Interrupt on-the-scene shots by shouting questions like, "Where have all the cowboys gone?" Ask strangers if they have change for a nickel. In the bathroom at work, utter loud, pain-racked screams, then emerge holding a large hen's egg. One, and there was something else here.
That's what they make bookmarks for.
Yeah, well, it wasn't too far ahead, so. Oh, here's one. Robert E. Lee and Ulysses S. Grant. Image: Grant, who commanded the Union Army, was against slavery. Lee, who commanded the Confederate Army, was for it. Actually, according to David Wallachinsky in Significa, both were slave owners, and the Southern General Lee freed his slaves before the Northern General Grant freed his. When Grant married his wife Julia, she had four slaves, and although he freed his own slave in 1849, Julia's slaves were not freed until the end of the Civil War. Mrs. Grant was an apologist for slavery all her life, and her husband stood up to her. On the other hand, Robert E. Lee once wrote, quote, "Slavery as an institution is a moral and political evil," unquote. In the late 1840s, Lee reportedly freed his four slaves, and he released his wife's slaves, whom he had inherited from his father-in-law in 1863, 2 years before those owned by Julia Grant gained their freedom.
It's interesting.
Yes.
The Civil War is so misunderstood. The war was not fought over slavery.
Well, yeah, they say today.
The war was fought over states' rights.
Yeah, but scholars today believe that that was pushed by women in the South after the war.
Yeah, well, I don't buy it.
Well, slavery was certainly the catalyst.
Slavery was one of the major issues, but the major issue was states' rights. Whether a state had the right to govern the people within that state as it saw fit.
Mm-hmm.
Which, to some degree, still occurs.
Well, you know, that reminds me, the people in, the natives in Hawaii want independence. You know, they want Hawaii to stop being a state and become their country again.
Never going to happen.
No, I don't think so.
Too much involved. Especially money.
Oh, yes. Well, of course, money is how they became a state.
That's true.
All right. Dog food for thought.
Like the title.
I wonder if other dogs think poodles are members of a weird religious cult. Rita Rudner. Did you ever walk into a room and forget why you walked in? I think that's how dogs spend their lives. Sue Murphy. When a man's dog turns against him, it is time for his wife to pack her trunk and go home to mama. Mark Twain. Mm-hmm. My dog is half pit bull, half poodle. Not much of a guard dog, but a vicious gossip. Craig Shoemaker. Let's see here. People who keep dogs are cowards who haven't got the guts to bite people themselves. August Strindberg. A dog is the only thing on this earth that loves you more than he loves himself. Anonymous. When a man's best friend is his dog, that dog has a problem. Edward Abbey. If dogs could talk, perhaps we could find out, I'm sorry, we would find it as hard to get along with them as we do with people. Carol Capek. The average dog is a nicer person than the average person. Andy Rooney. My dog is worried about the economy because Alpo is up 99 cents a can. That's almost $7 in dog money. Joe Weinstein. Strange but true names. Dennis O'Pray, rector of the Church of Our Savior in San Gabriel. Jesse James, Harry Hollywood, and Sherman Oaks, LAPD police officers. Daniel Waters and Norman Powers, officials in the Department of Water and Power. Jim Crooks, chief of LA County Criminal Justice Computer System. George Crook, LA lawyer, after he won a Golden Moniker Award from California Lawyer magazine, he wrote to the publication, "I am not a Nixon." Susan Tellum, public relations executive. Norm Reeder, in charge of Torrance Library programs. Steve Baer, an Angeles National Forest Ranger. Michael Park, a city recreation and park supervisor. Mark Usury, loan department employee at Western Federal Savings and Loan. John Argue, LA lawyer. Pardon. Bad jokes. Heard any good jokes lately? Not here, you haven't. Our jokes are awful and we love them that way. Heard any bad ones? Send them to us. What has four legs and one arm?
Beats
a
me.
Rottweiler.
A what?
A Rottweiler.
Don't get it.
You know, the attack dog?
I know what it is.
Yeah, all right.
I just don't get the...
Hear about the ship that ran aground carrying a cargo of red paint and black paint? The whole crew was marooned. A bus stops at a bus station. A train stops at a train station. Now you know why they call it a workstation. What is the difference between ignorance, apathy, and ambivalence? I don't know, and I don't care one way or the other. Did you hear about the corduroy pillows? They're making headlines. Did you hear about the Buddhist who refused Novocaine during his root canal? He wanted to transcend dental medication.
Oh, brother.
What do the letters DNA stand for? National Dyslexics Association. Did you hear about the two antennas that got married? The wedding was terrible, but the reception was great. What's the difference between mashed potatoes and pea soup? Anyone can mash potatoes.
Okay.
Ooh, boy. How much do pirates pay for their earrings? A buccaneer.
No, no.
That's quite enough of that.
Really?
We have about 3.5 minutes. Ooh.
While he's perusing his tome, means looking at his book, if you have any suggestions for books that you would like us to review, let us know.
Absolutely.
We would love to do that.
The hunt for Red October, powerful friend President Ronald Reagan. In 1984, a Maryland insurance broker named Tom Clancy wrote The Hunt for Red October, a naval thriller about a Soviet submarine captain who tries to defect to the United States. Clancy, a military buff, had never published a book before. His only author credits were for a three-page article on the MX missile and a single letter to the editor. And the Naval Institute Press had never published a work of fiction. But they liked Clancy's manuscript, so they bought it and printed 14,000 copies. President Ronald Reagan read The Hunt for Red October after it was recommended to him by a friend. And that's when a reporter just happened to ask what he was reading. Reagan praised the book as the perfect yarn and non-put-downable. That did the trick. The Hunt for Red October, which until then had received little attention and was selling slowly, shot up the bestseller lists.
Good book.
Ultimately, it sold more than 5.4 million copies, setting Tom Clancy on a course to become one of the best-selling authors in the 20th century.
And Hunt for Red October is a great book.
Mm-hmm. Love the movie.
Yep.
Now, we've only got about a minute and a half, so I'm not going to bother with the other book.
Now, what's the title of that one again?
Oh, the title of the book?
The book that you got in
your hand. Uncle John's All-Purpose Extra Strength Bathroom Reader.
Oh, okay. And it can be purchased?
You can get these at Barnes & Noble.
Oh, really?
Yes. And you can't go wrong with Uncle John. Oops! More tales of outrageous blunders to let us know that someone's screwing up even worse than we are. So go ahead and feel superior for a few minutes. Naked Ambition. 31-year-old stripper Roberto Pamplona suffered a broken nose and multiple injuries after performing his act in Milan, Italy. He was supposed to be stripping for a party in one room, but showed up next door, where the Catholic Mothers Against Pornography were meeting. The innocent mix-up angered the mothers, and Pamplona's act erupted into a riot halfway through the show.
We're almost finished there, Paul.
Yes, we are. So, Nicole, thank you for directing.
Indeed.
We love you. Thank you for watching.
We're done.
Thank you for being here, Roger. Have a wonderful day.